to Dustin and Hunter for helping to cover for me last weekend when I was not feeling well. I don't particularly like coming into church on a Sunday and having people say, "Oh, you're here." But we are blessed to have two guys on our staff leading music that are so dedicated to their faith. And so we thank you both for stepping up and helping cover for me and doing it so well. Amen. I'd like to, now, if you said amen on that, I'm waiting on some amens in my sermon. So we can see our scripture reading for today. It is a passage that comes from 1 John, not the Gospel of John, but the other three books that are there as a part of the Johannine literature. We are going to be focusing on chapter 4, verses 7 through 15, and I invite you to look along with me. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we were loved, or not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. Will you pray with me? Almighty God, as we come in this post-Christmastide season, we still come seeking deeper knowledge of you, seeking the wisdom that you have available for us. So I ask that you might guide my words, that they might be consistent with your will for us today. And if there is anyone here who needs to hear a different message, I ask that you might speak directly to their hearts, mind, and soul, that they may be aware of the love, care, peace, and comfort that you offer in this morning. For it is in your Son's name that we pray. Amen. Part of what we are dealing with when we are dealing with this passage of Scripture today, can you all hear me? The microphone's not on. I'm loud and I'm getting away from it. So, as we look at this passage of Scripture today, what we find is a little bit of a different context of Scripture. We don't know who the exact author is. We don't know who the exact audience is. We really don't know what is going on, except for this addresses a church community that is dealing with a split within the church. There are some Gnostic teachings, some non-Christian outside teachings that have come into the church, and some of the people in the church have come to find themselves quite worthy. You know what I mean? And at the same time, as they emphasize that piece, they also begin to emphasize the divinity of Christ and to slowly begin to downplay the human side of Christ. And so for those that lift up the humanity of Christ, thinking of Christ on the cross, and that meaning a great deal to them, are in opposition to this heretic group. And so as this church is dealing with a split, that is the context for this letter. And it asks the question, what is the job of the church? What are we supposed to be, and what are we supposed to do? Have you ever found yourself in a place in life where you could do anything if you could just have 5 minutes of God's time? Just so God can finally hear your voice and get your request correct. Right? We make requests, we wait for God, sometimes God doesn't do what we tell God to do, and we think, therefore, God is not acting. That God is not interested in what we're going through. But that's not true, right? We just have those fleeting moments. We just somehow want to be able to make contact with God. We want, like that woman who had been hemorrhaging for 12 years, who desperately just wanted to touch the garment of Christ, to just get a touch of the hem of his garment, because she had the confidence that if she did, out of her faith, she would be healed. Don't we sometimes want to be able to grasp God in that tangible way? Sometimes don't we just want to be held by God and just cry for a while, or just feel that love and feel good? I mean, we have lots of babies and young folks in here, right? And they want to be held. And in reality, when those small children are being held, the ones holding them are pretty excited about the deal too, right, Hank?
Yes.
The two-way joy of what it is to have a tangible connection, and sometimes even goes beyond the description of what is in words. And we see God representing God's self through Scripture in many different ways. When Moses goes up, he sees God interacting with him through the burning bush. We see God's voice in clouds. We see God's voice in angels. We see different ways in Scripture where God reaches out to humankind in tangible ways. But we also recognize that ultimate example of the tangibleness that God reaches out to us with in the giving of his Son. We see the reference there again, verse 11, very close to John 3:16. For God so loved us that we ought to love one another. God sent his Son into the world, not just for me to be saved, right? But for us to be saved. For us to receive that grace and to be people who celebrate that good news and who share that good news. We don't want to be a part of what is false, right? We want to be a part of what is correct and accurate and true. Because we know the truth never hurts, right? One Sunday morning when I was in Temple, Texas, and I was in church, and the service had started, and someone came and gave me a tap on the shoulder. Have you ever had one of those taps that is not "I love you" on the shoulder? And the taps came, and the person said, "Where are the youth?" And I looked around, and none of them were in church. And so immediately, my mind went where I would have been when I was their age. When I was in high school, and the sermon was getting ready to come, I would sneak out of church and go to my friend's house, and we would watch All Star Wrestling. Some of you don't even know what that is. But Andre the Giant, all these other characters that are in there, that's what we do. And then we'd sneak back in, and we'd make it before church was over, and our parents didn't know. Until now, my parents watch the video. So, but I went, and so that's where my mind was. I know they're up to something, and it's not good. So I go looking through the building. I can't find them anywhere. I'm like, man, I just know they went to the convenience store down the street. They're having soda. Their teeth are rotten out. All sorts of bad stuff's going on. So I give up, and I'm going back into the sanctuary. And to save time, I cut through the gym. And when I cut through the gym, I found the youth sitting in a circle at mid-course. So I walk over there and I say, "All right, what's going on? Y'all need to go up and go to church." And they're like, "Well, we have some concerns." So I sit in their little circle, and they begin to express to me their concerns about what's going on in adult church. Because what they see is a lot of people going in there, and they do their bit, and they listen, go out, but they really didn't feel like there was a spiritual depth that was taking place in the worship services. They didn't feel like they were getting anything out of the worship services. They thought church, and this is the only youth group that has ever thought this, that adult worship was boring and dry. Hard to imagine, right? And they really were genuinely concerned and not happy with the spiritual nature of what was going on in adult worship. Now, how many of you think that's admirable? How many of you all think that's horrible and you really feel sorry for the guy that's got to go tell the senior minister the next day the kids don't come to your door? Right? But I was really moved that the kids were taking things so seriously that they had decided to boycott church on that day, which is what they decided they were going to boycott. They gathered in the middle of the gym, and what they did was very authentic worship and very authentic reflection. They wanted something that was more tangible for them. They wanted something that they could take and have as a part of their faith journey and lead with it, instead of just playing tic-tac-toe or the four-square game, all those games that kids play in church that I used to play in church, but to actually get meat out of the service and to remember the fleshly sacrifice that was given in Christ. The tangible nature, the tangible story of a real Jesus the Christ. Now, if you are like me and you need some of those tangible moments, you are thankful for some things that we refer to in our Bible study from time to time, things like the book of Josephus, which gives an historical account of the life and the activity of Jesus, some of these people that start following him, and then they end up killing the guy. Historical reference, not a Christian book. He's a Jewish historian, has no Christian agenda. He's just making reference to such things. There's another book that's about 1/8 as thick as the book of Josephus, which is about that thick. And it is Howard Key, K-E-E, Jesus in History. For me, in my Christian journey, it is helpful to be able to look and see Jesus accounted for in history. To know that Jesus is not just a reference in Scripture, but there are other historical references that talk specifically about Jesus. There is no doubt, even amongst the skeptics, that Jesus Christ lived, impacted people, and was killed. Historic fact. Does that help you in your faith journey? To know that that aspect is true. There is a tangible nature to looking into history and seeing the words that have been passed through the course of time. A historical Jesus, flesh and bone, you cut me and I bleed, like you and I are cut and bleed. What it is to be human. Now sometimes we strive too hard to have that proven to us. Has anyone here ever read The Case for Christ? The struggle book? Okay, then you all can get upset about this. That's even better. We had our youth group, when I was in Wichita, they did A Case for Christ, a teenage version. And it was a journalist who was an atheist. And basically this book is his story about how his researching about the Christian faith, he went from an atheist to a Christian. And the first part of the book was rich. And the kids were really getting into the context. But if you don't know, as we were kind of laughing about a minute ago, kids have this real irritating nature about them. They tell the truth. And so as we started going more into the book, our kids started poking holes in his theories by the end of the book, right and left. And they joked it was like he was just trying to finish the book so he could get it published. We don't have to try to prove God to other people, because I believe God is able to prove God's self enough. If who doesn't get in the way? Us, right? How often do we get in the way of the tangible representation of God? And that's what the latter part of the scripture text highlights and brings to light. And it is the way that we love one another is how we prove the tangible nature of God for others. For example, isn't it great that every denomination in the United States gets along so well? We never say anything against another church, do we? I never make any Baptist jokes, do I? That's the best part. We look at the different things that make up Christianity, and sometimes what we don't carry out of these walls with us is the part of having Christ in our everyday life. What those kids were wanting in worship with the adults that was lacking is what we have lacking when we leave this place. We might come to church, we might be filled with spirit, we might be touched by music and song and prayers and other things, but it doesn't mean anything if we are not going out as the church with a part of our job, which is to take a tangible nature of God into the world. An example of love, a living grace that we share with one another, an ability to reach beyond the things that limit us, and embrace the things that make us great. The greatness that we are called to be because God has created us and called us. Good. God has created us and called us. Now some of you are not saying that very strong, which makes me think I need to start a whole other sermon. Do you think God makes you good? If God made you good, isn't that something you want to share with others? I mean, I know my mom and dad were always terrified I was going to hang out with the bad kid. And what my parents didn't know was the person they thought was the bad kid was the good kid. The person that they thought was the good kid was the bad kid. And I spent more time with the bad kid than I thought was the good kid. Who you hang out with, what words you use, the way you live your life makes a difference. And the love that we have for one another, the love we have for others outside of this place, is evidence of the existence of God. It is us partnering with God, making God more tangible in the world. Now, I'm going to make a little bit of a confession. I was at Refuge Fellowship a few months back, and there was a gentleman who was not a part of our church or the other church we partnered with, and we're doing the feeding of the homeless and the worship, and there was this guy, and he was bragging about how much he does for the homeless. And you know what I'm thinking in my mind? I'm not doing half what I'm doing. What are you talking about? He goes on and on, and he's talking about what he does for the homeless, and he goes, and you know, I carry bottles of water with me just to give. I care about those people. And I roll my eyes, and in my head, I'm having kind of a humorous response. And I remembered that this weekend, and I don't know why I didn't remember it before, but I remember this weekend, and I thought, oh my gosh, I'm such a jerk sometimes. The tangible nature of giving someone a bottle of water who is thirsty for a bottle of water, right? Just water. And so I kind of tried to make a vow to myself. Sometimes good things come out of a guilty conscience, right? And so I would try to make an effort in my own way of loving one another, that I'm going to try to start carrying water in my car, and I'm going to try to one-up that guy since I made fun of him, I don't people making fun of me, and socks. And if you know anything about the homeless community, you know how important socks are. There are lots of uses for socks. So I'm going to start trying to carry water and socks, so if y'all want to come up to my car one day and check, feel free to do so, and if I don't, I'll come up with some excuse, I hope, to survive. But what are you doing to spread that kind of love in the world? What are you doing where you don't have to say, I am giving you a bottle of water in the name of God, but you just do it because it's who you are, because it's your nature, it's God's creation, that God has created and God has called. Thank you. Hey, just different. God has created us for so much. And God has empowered us for so much. And we are a part of that tangible representation of God in this world. If I'm not going to do it, if you're not going to do it, who is? May we be challenged and may we respond for God's glory's sake. Amen.
At this time, you're all invited to stand as you're comfortable and join us in the hymn, "We Give Thee But Thine Own," hymn number 382, verses 1, 3, and 5.